rather than a special one like Christmas.
In 1950, Turing predicted that within 100 years, we'd be able to have a conversation like that on any subject with a machine. However, there are those who say we can do it now, 50 years early. This is what they're talking about. This is Ella. Don't be fooled by the picture. She's a machine, and I'm supposed to be able to have a conversation with her. So let's give it a try. What's she saying here? Hello, my name's Ella. Nice to meet you. Please tell me what name I should call you. Jeremy, say, does being a man pay well? Do you like cheese? I'm not so excited about cheese. A little is okay. I saw the Doobie Brothers there. How did it look to you? You've never heard of the Doobie Brothers, have you? What's heard of the Doobie Brothers like? You don't even know where to put apostrophes. She's intelligent in the same way that I think my dog's intelligent. Who, what, where, why, hen, how? You should be a newspaper reporter. Again, let me change the subject a little. She doesn't know, does she? One of the AI community's leading lights is Professor Kevin Warwick.
Well, this is a robot head.
Dissatisfied with vacuum cleaners and robot dogs, Kevin's gone one stage further. His cyborg comes complete with
radar in its nose and an infrared top lip.
Is it intelligent?
Well, in a very limited way, I guess it is. It's sort of a basic instinct. What do I do with this information that I'm getting? How do I move? How do I operate if this signal is different?
So what's it doing now?
Well, if you clap your hands...
Oi, over here. Oh, it did it.
It's making basic decisions. All we've got it doing here is programmed to make basic decisions based on that sensory information that's coming in.
Getting the information in is nothing. That's like picking up a book. That's not an intelligent thing to do. Reading the book and knowing what the words mean, that's surely the intelligence.
Many machines can read books nowadays, but it means something different electronically to the machine as it would mean to a human.
Though the cyborg head does a reasonable job of sensing, it can't really interact with or explore its surroundings. It's fastened to its robot arm. And according to Kevin, it's only as intelligent as a dishwasher.
If that's a dishwasher...
Yes.
Where are these in terms of... Are they dolphins, chimps?
I think you'd have to say... it's about the 50 to 100 brain cell area. So, realistically, you're talking slugs and snails.
But a slug and a snail, they know to eat. They know. These things don't...
They have some innate abilities.
There's no self-preservation with that.
Well, we do have. This the power supply, they don't have their own batteries. They each have power they're picking up from the floor here. That's where they're getting their energy. That's where they're getting their food
from. But if you turned off this section of the floor...
If we turn off this
section,
they have a basic instinct to go and look for some power somewhere
else.
They will keep going to do that until they find some.
So if I put him down...
It should go off looking.
So he'll have to go and look for power. Yeah. Are you going to tell him to do that?
No, it's an innate response for that robot. It's a basic thing.
Self-preservation.
Yeah.
Now, his lights have come back on.
Lights have come on.
So he's found power.
He's happy now that he's getting power. Away to go.
What would happen if all the old, stupid computers we have now suddenly stopped working? Realistically, you'd need a lot of explosives to rid the world of all computers. But for microprocessors, there's something even more devastating than TNT. EMP,
an electromagnetic pulse. They say that if an EMP device was exploded here, 300 miles above us, anything containing a silicon chip would stop working. Europe would, in effect, be switched off.
Hello.
Oh, not the coffee machine. Oh, please, no. So, the EMP scenario. It's the latest Hollywood gimmick, really. Been used by everyone from Bond baddies to Matrix good guys via George Clooney and Brad Pitt in Ocean's 11. Thing is, though, would it actually work?
Somewhere in England, there's a secret facility where the EMP death ray can be summoned up at the flick of a switch. An EMP strike would occur instantaneously, but what you're about to witness is EMP in slow motion. Inside the chamber, we can see what happens through specially hardened CCTV units. Our cameras wouldn't stand a chance. With the hapless PC entombed, the electromagnetic charge is racked up.
We'll just carry on increasing the stress.
And here's the scary bit. You can switch the computer back on, but there's no point. It's gone mad.
Looks like we've lost BIOS, yeah. We've got a message saying invalid electronic serial number. That effectively the computer's lost its identity. We get an error message saying that it cannot find the hard disk. This is symptomatic of something that an EMP event could cause. And that's a catastrophic failure.
EMP would mean the end of the Western world. It would mean no computers. This in turn would mean no electricity, no telephones, no cars. Supermarket shelves would empty, never to be replenished. Aeroplanes would fall from the sky. To say that the computer has become a double-edged sword seems somehow inadequate. We worry about whether or not it's going to take over. And yet, without our silicon servant, if microprocessors were removed, we'd almost certainly descend into anarchy within the week.
There's no doubt that the computer has changed our world out of all recognition in an incredibly short period of time. And it seems the really major developments are still to come. Pretty soon, they say, the useless idiot that sits on your desk crashing every 5 minutes will become truly benevolent, pandering to your every whim and fantasy. Well, that's what they say. But these are the people, remember, who promised that I'd be wearing a Baco foil suit by the year 2000 and living on a diet of pills. They said the moon would be colonized in my lifetime and that my dog would need a space helmet. So you'll forgive me if I remain a little bit sceptical about the claims being made for the future of the computer. Apart from anything else, I'm not sure that I want voice recognition or a laptop that says, "Hello, Jeremy," in an American accent every morning. And I definitely don't want anything PC inserting in me. Good night.
Next, rare archive footage and expert testimony combine to give an unprecedented insight into acts of terror. International terrorism laid bare here on UK TV History.